In today's video, I'm going to show you some more tips, tricks, and techniques for editing a cinematic video in CapCut. A video like this, for example. And guys, look, when it comes to editing a video like this, especially when you're just starting out, keep it simple, okay? Don't make it too complicated. Less is always more. And these days with social media and online video, there are companies who will pay you for simple product videos like this that they can then use on their socials. And they're not asking for crazy complicated edits. No, they're asking for simple but good. That's it. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that it's easy. And even though this video is about editing, I also want to emphasize that it all starts with an idea and filming your idea, of course. If you already mess up there, then, well, there's no way to fix it with editing. And I'll link the behind the scenes video of how I shot that sequence in the description, in case you're interested. And I'm using CapCut for desktop, by the way, but for all you mobile shooters, there's also a mobile version and even an online version. So, I mean, use whatever you want. Okay, here we go. This first tip or trick or whatever you want to call it might seem super stupid, but it's actually super useful and important. Because when you're filming something, sometimes a shot is easier when you do it in reverse. Especially if you're using manual focus. Here's a simple example. If I want to do a push-in shot and end with the subject in focus, well, I have to make sure that I end the shot at exactly the right distance from the subject to get it in focus. So it's actually easier to start close to the subject, set the focus manually, then hit record, and then pull away from the subject. And then just reverse the shot in CapCut. And it's super simple, just select your clip and then hit the reverse button here. That's it. And so it might seem super simple and stupid, but it will make shooting your sequence a whole lot easier. CapCut has some really cool built-in transitions and a lot of them, but the thing is that you can't just pick any random transition and drop it on your cut. It doesn't work like that. If you want to make a transition seamless and smooth, you should already think about the transition when you're filming. Because a transition works best when it's used to connect two shots that already have the same transitioning movement. You know what I mean? Well, let me just show you, because it sounds more complicated than it is. Here, for example, to make the transition from this clip to this one, this is what it looks like without transition. It already looks decent with a hard cut because we're transitioning from this downward movement here in this shot to the same kind of downward movement in this clip. But adding a transition with the same movement, some kind of zoom in this case, the pull-in for example, will make everything even smoother. And so when you're filming your sequence, already think about the transitions you want to use because it will make everything a whole lot easier. So it looks a lot better with the transition, but we can actually make it look even better. Because right now, the movement of the first shot here, right before the transition, is actually a bit slow compared to the actual transition. You know, the downward movement here. And I would also like to have some more zoom in effect right before the transition to make it look even smoother. So what I'm gonna do is add some keyframes to zoom in this clip at the end here digitally. So put the playhead a few frames before the transition, then hit this little diamond here to create a keyframe for scale, and then move the playhead to the end of the clip. And sometimes it's easier to make the clip a little bit longer temporarily to make the keyframe. And then here in this keyframe, I will increase the scale. And now the clip will zoom in over time from this keyframe to this one. And then I make the clip shorter again to make it look smooth. So now the whole movement of the end of the first clip over the transition to the start of the next clip is like, it's like all the same speed and movement, and it looks a lot smoother. And the same goes for speed ramps. You can use them to make the movement in your shots look even smoother, or to change the movement of your shots almost, to make it match the music, the rhythm of the music, for example. Because the opening shot of that sequence that you saw, this shot, Well, that's not what the original shot looks like. The original shot looks like this. Very slow and boring. So instead of that slow and boring movement, I want it more like a, you know what I mean? That's what I wanted. You know what I mean. And I used a speed ramp to do that, or multiple speed ramps actually. How? Well, select clip, then go to speed here, and then curve, and then custom. You need the custom one. And this is a visual representation of the speed of your clip. So you can make parts of your clip go faster. If you raise one of these points here, then at that point of the clip will speed up. So it will speed up from here until here, and then it will slow down again. And if I pull it down, it will slow down. You can also split the points like this to make a more abrupt ending when it slows down. And you can also add more points. And so you can actually change the movement of your shot. You can speed it up, slow it down. So for my opening shot, at the end of the clip, it looks like this, the speed ramp. So it speeds up when the camera moves up, and then it slows down again at the top, and then it speeds up again when the camera drops down. And the speed ramp combined with that keyframed zoom and the transition makes everything look super smooth and yummy. My blue light, it died. Now what? I can't go on without the blue light. I feel so naked without the blue light. Actually, it doesn't look too bad. Okay, let's do the last one without the blue light. The last one, what was it? Oh yeah, animated text. So CapCut has a bunch of built-in templates, but just like transitions, those templates don't always work like you want them to work with your sequence. But there's an easy fix for that. So this template, for example, a simple clean one that I used for that sequence. When you drop it on the timeline, you can customize everything here, but sometimes it's a bit limited and I wanted to do some more customization. So what I did is I split up the template. So I duplicated it and then I used the top one for the top text and the bottom one for the bottom text. And so you have a lot more control. You still have both animations, but you can control them more. And you can put them wherever you want. You can also play around with the timing, make one come in sooner than the other. So, you know, it gives you a lot more control. So yeah, it's a super simple way to customize the templates even more. And then finally, a bonus tip and maybe also a super shameless plug. For the colors, I kept it super simple. I used one of my LUTs to do the color grading. I've imported all my LUTs into CapCut and now I can use them right here. And then I selected this one and boom, that's it. I tweaked the brightness and the contrast a little bit and that is it. So, you know, you can check out my LUTs on my website or of course you can just use your favorite LUTs. You don't have to buy my LUTs, but I mean, if you want to support me a little bit so that I can eat in the weekend, yeah, that would be helpful. But anyway, guys, that's it. Like I always say, the best way to learn is by doing. So go film something and then just try the things that I showed you in this video and other CapCut videos. And practice, practice, practice. That's the most important thing. Thank you so much for watching. Salut and tot de volgende. Oh, my blue light. I don't understand. Aren't LED lights supposed to like, you know, go on forever? Wait, what? What? I unplugged it and it works again. What is this sorcery? I unplugged it and it works again. I'm flabbergasted.